Hello, everybody. Yes, thank you so much for being here. Thank you to the cast of Nightmare on Elm Street for Dream Master. Were you guys disappointed you didn't get a cool Dying song with your movie? It's all right, but I'll just continue. For those of you who are new to Nightmare on Elm Street,
so we're sharing.
Oh,
it's
live.
Oh, tell him.
Well, yes, hi.
Thank you. She's like not very conspicuous.
Why are we conspicuous? We're all friends.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Woo! You're good.
All right, cool.
All right. Please welcome Theiss. What was it like to be cast in a new Nightmare on Elm Street movie? Or to be coming back to another to do another Nightmare on Elm Street movie?
Oh, when I came back, it was so short, I never knew I got
it. R.I.P. Kincaid. how exciting was it to be cast in a Nightmare on Elm Street movie?
Took me over 2 months.
Wow.
Each time they kept saying, don't wear makeup. I kept wearing makeup. So please don't wear makeup. And they was like, oh, don't wear makeup. And then I got the part, so.
You did it to yourself.
Well, yeah, no, they wanted me a hip square.
Yeah.
So there you go. That's it. It was fun. Nightmare was good.
I came back in 4 after having been decapitated in 3. First moment on the stage with Robert, we were doing a scene, and I said, I have to ask you a question. And he said, sure, go ahead. I said, so, I don't understand. I mean, I got killed. Decapitation is killing. How come back and forth? He said, Brooke. And I said, what? He said, shut up.
Just be grateful.
yeah, totally awesome, because I was a fan of Nightmare on Elm Street from the beginning, and all horror since I've been little, and I had this huge crush on Rodney Eastman, Joey, and the Nightmare 3. So when I got cast in Nightmare 4, I was really excited. But we didn't have any scenes together. But the interesting thing is, and Annette Benson says that literally, they auditioned hundreds of gals. I was rejected. They didn't want to audition me because I looked like in my headshot, which I have an example on my table. Blonde, makeup, all of that, and so it didn't look like, you know, Alice, right? So finally, they went through hundreds, and they went through the reject pile, which I was in. I got to audition, and I went in with no makeup, and like dirty hair, pale yellow, my worst color, and auditioned, and I had one callback on a Friday, got married that Sunday, 150 people wedding, and on my honeymoon learned that I got the role of Alice. And then they asked me to dye my hair red. Which was cool. My mom's a redhead.
Dyed every day.
Every day.
Oh,
it was a rinse.
A rinse in the chair every day. I was like, oh, I'm so sorry.
I know. And now I'm going to interject real quick. Does it seem just really cool?
Oh, you did it again!
Wow.
She always. I was trying
to. Always take the microphone. Just trying to upstage us.
So long.
That was your cue to be.
I was on TV. You started really quick. The the scene real quick went up the boiler room, and Kristen has called me into her dream, and I'm in a white nightgown, and I'm walking through tentatively and whatever. The director says, cut, what the hell is all over the white nightgown? Well, the rinse they put in my hair, because they're getting me wet, is now draining all over my white nightgown. So they had to stop filming, had to stick my head in a sink to wash the rinse out, and then resume filming.
Just like Rudy Giuliani.
two blow dryers going to dry it.
Oh,
it's crazy.
You did? I didn't know that.
Oh, yeah, that was painful.
Oh, thank you.
I used to dye my mother's hair, so.
Oh, so you know.
Yeah.
I have a question. Where the hell is my
So I didn't even know if I was going to die or not until we got the script in its entirety. And then I was like, oh my God, that's pretty cool. My first on-screen kiss is with Freddy Krueger. And then here's a great one. When I was, because they did my special effects first, so the dummy, they put a cast over my head, and they had my mouth open, and they put the mold, and they got the doll ready. So then I went to go shoot the scene. And in the scene, they're like, okay, well, Robert, you're gonna come in and toy, your mouth is gonna be wide open because your doll's mouth is open. I said, okay, great. Well, it was after lunch and Robert wore dentures. And so when he came in to kiss me one of the times, the dentures slipped out. And it was like saliva and grits and grime and maybe some corn, I don't know.
You sure Robert wants to say that?
He's like, can we reenact it? He's like, so that was my death scene.
How about Brooke, your
I think
very
for me,
memorable
yeah,
person.
You know, I remember flipping through the script and going, oh, I get turned into a cockroach. Okay, what are I going to do that? Like, little did I know. Like 2 weeks of you know, prosthetics and sets, and because I had three different sets, and it was so many moving parts because I was in a box, I was out of the box, I had prosthetics on my elbows, and they took that off, and then I had prosthetics on my shoulders, and they took that off, and then I had the whole set of prosthetics, and then I was in the goo, and then I was in the whole full cockroach costume. So yeah, I was like, oh, that's how they're gonna do that.
Well, it's funny because we were in the ADR session together. It's afterwards, sometimes you have to loop over your voiceover. I remember they said to Brooke, we were, you know, kind of talking, and Rennie says, so Brooke, I'm going to need you to make some cockroach noises. She was like, cockroach noises? And what did you do? What the fuck?
Now everybody's waiting to hear what it sounds
like.
He swipes my head, so I have to go back like this, and then gets the other head, and then comes into her room and starts ripping up the pillows with these with his hands. So it had to be all in one shot. So it was, and I am very clumsy. I mean,
flattest of surfaces. So, which I can convey to him. But we rehearsed it over and over and over and over, choreographed it. And it turns out we just had to do it once. But it was a little scary. I mean, those, you know, they're like this big and they're sharp, like razor sharp. So that was, yeah, but he was so wonderful about choreographing it and so careful with me. So it was really, I owe him a lot.
Yeah. I know a little bit from watching the Never Sleep Again documentary, but can you talk a little bit about your experiences working with Rennie Harlan? I know this was only his, I think, second English language movie. He had made Prison, and then this was his next movie after that, but can you guys talk a little bit about working with Rennie Harlan? Sure.
He was a different director than Chuck Russell. They both was two different people. For me, I learned from both of them, you know, whereas Chuck Russell gave you time. When I first did Kincaid was originally written for a white guy. And so he allowed me to do some little things, to change some things, to add my little nuances in there. That, because I told him a black guy just wouldn't say this shit. So, being a writer myself, I wanted to respect the writer, but had to get the permission for him. But Randy was okay because when we did Four, I don't know about you all, they didn't have a script. The writers was on strike.
Yeah.
So Rodney and I, when we went there, it was literally one page and a paragraph. And so he could have zoomed that and he was zooming with me. But, you know, so he talked to us about what it was going to be like, and we didn't literally get a script like about a day before we was going to shoot. Of course, I didn't have to learn it.
What I like most about Rennie is all the pre-stuff that we did. So Rennie had the whole cast, the kids anyhow, hang out like a couple of times.
You all hung out?
Yeah.
Why were you there?
We did. He had barbecues and
gatherings. I was the last person cast, and I get cast again on my honeymoon, which I had to end early to go to the film, so I didn't get to go to any of your barbecues. Aww. You're like, oh, it's the new girl.
You're like, I was here first.
That's your name. No, I'm just saying.
Yeah.
I know it didn't.
And they didn't have any bitchy mommies at the barbecue.
But what it did allow was, like, the first day, shooting day, we were all friends.
Yeah.
So we had instant chemistry. So that was genius. I've never had a director do that.
Yeah, same here.
Yeah.
What do you think? I talked to a lot of people who point to Nightmare 4 as their absolute favorite of the franchise. What do you think makes this one stand out from the others? Or what makes each of the nightmares is unique in its own way? What would you say is unique about part four?
I think it's really about, it was that MTV generation and the music behind it, the drama, everything, like, kind of, right? It tied it together, and it was almost like a visual special effects, and it was, you know, real special effects, of course, CGI, mixed with, you know, hot music, and it was the graphics with it. I think it just fit that 1987 feel of, like, you know, MTV. That's what
kids.
And if it happened, you see a monster on the beach wearing Ray-Bans.
Yeah.
I mean, it was like fun.
No. I think also Freddie really kind of came into his own. His humor, the way he devised different deaths for the different kids, mm-hmm. based on, you know, whatever they liked and stuff. So I think it was a whole new Freddie that people were seeing. And as much as you were scared of him, he was kind of like really kind of cool.
His one-liners.
Yeah, his one-liners.
I mean, we still listen to the music today, like those songs. I'm like, I listen to 80s music a lot. And
Coast Guard.
Yeah.
Depends on my radio station.
Yeah.
The movie was cool, is what I'm putting it. It had that cool thing going. Fred was, like I said, with the sunglasses on, the acting beach and everything. And in the other movie before that, we was too busy to run it, but it was like cool. But the reason that also happened tonight on Elm Street for me and for a large person of color is because it made history. It made me the first African American to ever survive a horror film.
If you guys have questions, we'll have time for a couple of audience questions. You can line up at that microphone there. Can you speak just a little bit about working, obviously, with Robert England? I know he's here this weekend, so you guys are having run-ins with him all weekend and taking photos with him. But what's the experience like working with him? He's played the part 3 times now already. He's MTV Freddy for the first time. What was that like?
It was amazing. I mean, I at the time had just graduated from high school for the arts, and so we did a lot of Shakespearean study work, and when he found out that I knew Shakespeare, he would pull me aside and give me lessons on Macbeth and, you know, King Lear, and he would give me, you know, the reasons behind it, and I really forget that he is a, you know, a thespian, a true actor trained on the stage. And so I always had this, you know, he glows to me because his knowledge is so deep. And we only see him as Freddy, but I think because he knows how to embody from theater acting. Like, so when I was a young girl, I was just always in awe of him. And just, he took so much time. And I think he does that with everyone here. Like, if you actually go and sit and talk with him, he'll find a connectivity with you and say, okay, now let's drive that. And I think that's his gift. Like, he was so gracious with us. Really was. He was a great man.
Robert, I was a fan of the different Elm Street series, and I was really nervous the first day on set, and he's there, and I'm like, be cool, you know? And then I spent all that time in the makeup trailer having my hair, Robert's put in my hair. Well, Robert, of course, had his makeup being put on for 4 hours. So we had, you know, when the blow dryer wasn't running, we had a lot of time to chat, and he's just like such a cool guy. I remember we were just sitting there chatting, you know, he's becoming Freddy with the prosthetics, and he was remodeling his bathroom, and we were talking about grout color. And then we started talking about, I don't know, architecture in Maine. I don't know. We just, and he knows a lot. He's just knowledgeable about every subject from A to Z, seriously. And he's just a really cool guy. Yeah. Uncle Robert.
So true. You know, I'll tell you a quick story. We went to, were you there in Germany? You went to Germany with us.
No.
So we were in Germany doing a convention. And afterwards, we all left and we took a train into Amsterdam. And so it was like, you know, a side, whatever, we're just going. And we all broke off. And I was there with my husband, and I'm looking at the Van Gogh. We went to the Van Gogh Museum, and I'm staring at it. And this man walks up behind me and is just like, do you want a sunface? And I turn around, and it was Robert. And I'm like, that's really in Amsterdam? Like, Van Gogh.
So. I was just reminded of it. I had no idea what this was about. It was a job for me.
I got it. I was really happy with working, blah, blah, blah. So I'm sitting on set, and again, just, I have no prior knowledge of Nightmare 1 or 2. So I'm sitting on the set, and I notice over in the corner there's like hubbub. The producer, the director, the wardrobe person, and they're all very animated and everything. I don't know what that's about. So go over and find out. Turns out someone broke into the studio. It broke into a studio. That's a pretty serious offense. To steal Freddie's sweater. They're risking jail time. And I thought, oh my God, I'm into something big. But it was, I mean, they were all backup sweaters and stuff like that, so it didn't stop production. But it was really like a gem of an aha moment.
Yeah,
yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah.
And I gave you sweater back.
Choose your death in the Nightmare on Elm Street series, like if you could reshoot it, what would you choose? choose from your character?
Wait, one more time?
If you could, like, reshoot your death scene, what would you choose for your character?
Like a different kind of death?
Yeah.
Are you guys followers?
Lisa didn't die, so she doesn't get to answer this question. Alice fucking lives.
Thank you all so much.